This video is sponsored in part by Skillshare. It's 2:43 a.m. and I've given up. I'm in my kitchen taking half a sleeping pill because 3 days earlier I spent 23 hours flying across 9 time zones from Sydney to New York City, and my jet lag is horrible. Actually, the worst I've ever had. I've been trying to fall asleep for 4 hours. It's now been 7 days since I arrived in New York. I still can't fall asleep before 2 a.m. and I've missed 2 morning meetings and a dentist appointment. So in an attempt to unpack my own problems, I started to search, why do we get jet lag? And how can we fix it? And the answers are wrapped up in some pretty fascinating sleep science. Now, your body has a lot of ways of keeping time. You have tiny molecular clocks in most of the major systems in your body. So to keep your body in sync, your brain has a master body clock, which is a group of about 20,000 nerve cells that form a structure called the SCN. The SCN receives direct input from your eyes. So based on the amount of light you're seeing, it sends signals about the time of day to the rest of your body and brain, keeping your body clock in tune with the world around you. These signals about when you should be awake and when you should be sleepy are the way that your brain regulates the timing of your circadian rhythm. You've probably heard of your circadian rhythm before. It's produced by your body clock and is your daily cycle of being awake and not awake and awake and not awake. This circadian drive is one process that regulates sleep. The other is your homeostatic drive. This is your biological urge to sleep, and it's more straightforward. The longer you've been awake, the more tired you get. You'll feel the most tired when your homeostatic urge to sleep is high and your circadian clock is also sending signals that it's time to sleep. Normally, these two things should happen at about the same time. But when you travel across time zones, things get lagged. Say you shift 5 time zones, like New York to London. Your homeostatic drive is saying you've been awake for ages, so it's time to sleep. But your circadian clock is like, oh, fun, it's only 7 p.m. It's definitely not bedtime yet. And this disconnect between our homeostatic and circadian drives is why we can't sleep. Then we get fatigued and have mood swings and make questionable decisions and can't run as fast and have different bowel movements. These are all symptoms of jet lag. But in some cases, jet lag can be worse than others. Researchers found that jet lag is worse traveling east than traveling west, which is something I can personally attest to. This is because it's easier to delay than advance your circadian rhythms. Think about it this way. It's way easier to stay up when you're tired than to try and fall asleep when you're not tired at all. In what seems like a torturous experiment, researchers in Australia flew their study participants from Sydney to Qatar for 4 days and then back to Sydney to have a look at the impact of traveling in either direction. From this, they estimated that the time it takes you to adapt to a new place is half a day per hour of time difference west and 1 day per hour of time difference east, which means that since the time difference from Sydney to New York is 14 hours, it could take me another week, 2 weeks, to return back to normal. So at this point, you're probably wondering, is jet lag avoidable? Or am I doomed? Well, this is where the fascinating sleep science comes back into it. Your brain's master clock will take some time to shift, but there's a few things you can do to speed it up. If you want to shift your schedule earlier, you need to increase your light exposure in the morning. So set an alarm and, for the love of science, get up and get outside, even if you only had a few hours sleep. Otherwise, your sleep cycle will be thrown off for way longer. And don't use your devices before bed. In the hour before you're planning on sleeping, keep the lights dim. Melatonin supplements have also been found to help people get to sleep, and I'll link to more information on that in the video description. Now, if you want to shift your schedule later, stay up for as late as you can. And if you wake up early, stay in a dark-ish environment without using your devices until it's a reasonable time to get up. And since you have tiny molecular clocks all around your bodily systems, try to keep your meal times on track with your new location, rather than just eating constantly or having a midnight snack. Through this whole process, I discovered that studying jet lag scientifically is actually really, really hard because there are so many variables, like people's age and fitness levels and gender and medications and typical sleep patterns and distance that they're traveling and direction that they're traveling, and this list could go on forever. Your brain is a complicated machine, so much so that we can't cure jet lag, but research has found a few things we can do to lessen the impact. Keep in mind that your human body was not designed to travel across 9 time zones in 23 hours. And in the future, when there's people living on Mars and commercial space travel and you're bullet training across America, there will still be jet lag. For me, taking photos while I was traveling was like my gateway drug from science into YouTube. If you want to level up your photography skills, Skillshare have a bunch of great online courses, like the fundamentals of DSLR photography and how to take pro photos on your iPhone. Skillshare is the sponsor of today's video. They're an online community that have thousands of courses you can use to upskill in everything from marketing to animation to photography. You can learn how to adjust ISO, shutter speed, and use the rule of thirds like a pro. An annual subscription is less than $10 a month, and for BrainCraft viewers, you can get a 2-month free trial by using the link in the description. Thanks.